genealogical point is covered by a fractal landscape orbited by three megalithic moons. These moons remain geologically active due to the intense tidal forces generated by their gravitational interactions. This kind of arrangement is incredibly rare. You can see magma in the fissures between the tectonic plates on the moons. The inhabitants of this world and the dragons are technologically similar.
To fight their way across the Oren bridges in the center of the city. In spite of heavy civilian casualties, the French welcomed the liberators enthusiastically. He was a silversmith by trade. But from this April night in 1775, history was to remember him all the year as a messenger of the American Revolution. It all began back in 1660. Britain didn't always rule the way. In order to promote her overseas trade and sea power, she deliberately set trade regulations that prohibited goods from being transported to the 17 colonies, except in English ships and ships with her colonies. Other trade regulations included taxes and restrictions on intercolonial trade. The 13 colonies merchants got angry, and they stayed that way until 1764. In that year,
Thank you. In the 1660s, Old London was centered along the Thames River, the avenue to the world, both the old and the new. This was an age of expansion. Boston, Massachusetts was the seaport of the 13 colonies, while New France was being made a province of France, complete with governor and merchant adventurers. The same kind of men who had sent the first Virginia settlers on their way about 60 years before were now embarking on new profit ventures. Soon to include one into Hudson's Bay. Lying at rest in the Thames is the Hudson's Bay Company Coach, Nansen, ready to take on island affairs to trade with the Indians. In that exciting terminal, many of the world's foremost English characters grew to manhood. Daniel Defoe, best known today for his Robinson Crusoe story, was a teenager. Jonathan Swift, creator of Lemuel Gulliver and all his fascinating travels to Lilliput and beyond, was a mere baby. And Samuel Pepys, who left such a vast reservoir of information on the happenings of that day, was writing his Pepys diary in London, in the 1660s. Performers, trainers, and animals used the time to relax from the weary grind of the circus tour. New acts would rehearse their routines, high-wire artists prepared more thrilling stunts, and the clowns practiced funnier pratfalls. Even the animals had new tricks to learn. The wagons and the trains required the most attention. Built to last, they were called rocks of Gibraltar's on wheels. In the shops, new wagons were built with elaborate and ornate wood carving. Each piece fashioned individually by a carver with chisel and metal. Puppet tours of the winter headquarters were always an adventure. Around every corner, there was something new and fantastic to see. By spring, the new paint was dry, the performers relaxed, and the animals rehearsed. All aboard for the new circus season. Now, come along with us to the next scene on the entrance hall in an open lot or field. That's where the circus would set up. There were tents for dressing rooms and tents to house the menagerie. But the biggest tent to hold the stunning and spectacular performances was the big top. The Ringling Brothers introduced the first three-ring circus in 1881, setting a pattern for years to come. Each ring would feature a different act, something for everyone. As illustrated by our miniature animations, the audience was captivated by the action happening in every ring. Usually, before the main performance of the big top, a visit was paid to the menagerie tent. This is where you might catch your first glimpse of real, wild, and exotic animals. Most of American zoos in the late 19th century. With the advent of sports arenas and large exhibition halls, came the demise of the big top. Ringling Brothers Bonham and Bailey ended their use of the big top in 1957. The big top show is over. And experience the glory of the world. And the bells and all the bells and Roberts on his chance to take control of Camelot. He reached out through the Mormon's treachery and he returned to the valley with a leader in defense of his kingdom and a place called Camelot. But to what reason at all, the battle lasted all day. Almost all perished in the conflict. As Arthur and Mordred met, they charged each other. Mordred was mortally wounded, and he died at Arthur's feet. Arthur's wounds were severe, but he was helped from the battlefield by Sir Bedivere. Even before the Battle of Camelot, Arthur had watched his kingdom fall into decline. One thing made him believe would restore life to Camelot.
perished on the journey. The search for the Holy Grail was a long and arduous one. In the end, Sir Galahad, son of Sir Lancelot, found the Grail. The quest was complete, but alas, it was not enough to save Arthur or Camelot. In the aftermath of the Battle of Camelot, one of the few survivors, Sir Bedivere, helped Arthur to the shoreline. Arthur's wounds were severe, and he would soon be carried away to the Isle of Avalon. However, he must fulfill one last promise made years earlier, so he commanded Bedivere to take Excalibur, his sword, and go to the lake edge and throw it into the lake. Once Bedivere had done that, Arthur knew that the circle was now complete, and Excalibur was now returned to the Lady of the Lake. As the sun sets on both the Great Battle and Kingdom of Camelot, Arthur and Bedivere can only wait patiently for the ship that will take him to Avalon. There he'll be nursed back to health, and await to return someday, when once again a great king is needed to unite all of Britain. Our telling of the legend is a compilation of many of the versions from across the centuries. No one knows if, in fact, there was an Arthur, or a Round Table, or a Camelot. However, the legend endures and continues to evolve and reflect the generation telling the story. Writers, poets, historians, and movie makers and scholars through the ages have all left their mark on the legend. Perhaps the continuing quest to find the definitive Camelot is what makes the story timeless. Dark ages in Britain, a legend was born. One of a magical sword, a sorcerer, a round table, and a young king that would unite all of Britain and build a wondrous kingdom called Camelot. In the centuries since, there have been varying interpretations of the legend, but most have had one thing in common. Arthur and Camelot. Thank you.